Hello there. I'm Bayless Conley, and I want to welcome you and invite you to spend the next few minutes with me. We're going to be talking about some specific things that God tells us to pursue. And this first one actually deals with a dramatic season, I believe, that the church is coming into. You are going to want to hear about this. If you've got a Bible, grab one. Let's sit down together and study the Word of God. Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers. This series that we're doing right now is entitled Great Pursuits, and it revolves around a number of things that God Himself, specifically in the Bible, tells us that we must pursue. Now, He tells us to pursue them, number one, because they're really important, and number two, because even though they're important, and even though they may be within the scope of His will for us, we'll never experience them unless we go after them, and that's why God tells us to pursue these things. And the subject that we come to today, I feel, is so important, especially within the context that we find it. We're going to be talking about the pursuit of love. And listen, don't think, oh, yeah, here we go, another sermon on love. What else is on TV right now? No. You don't know what I'm going to share with you. Friend, this is good. It's from the Bible, but it's good, and it can change your life. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 1 says this, "Pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy." Now, I think we could spend an entire year and more just talking about the pursuit of love, and it could be applied to salvation, it could be applied to marriage, it could be applied to family, it can be applied to casting out fear, to trusting God, to dealing with enemies, to getting along with people in the church, and on and on and on. But we're going to deal with it simply in the context that we find it here, and that is within the setting of spiritual gifts. He said to pursue love and desire spiritual gifts. You know, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, or they're also called the manifestations of the Holy Spirit, are very, very important. In fact, it's so important the Apostle Paul took three whole chapters to write about them and to explain their function. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 talks about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, their distribution, and he gives us the definitions of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 talks about the spirit or the attitude that should characterize their use. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 talks about regulations, rules, guidelines, if you would, for their manifestation or for their functioning within the context of the local church. 1 Corinthians 12 is about the gifts. 1 Corinthians 13 is about the gifts. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 is about the gifts. Now, he said, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts. In fact, that phrase, desire spiritual gifts, we find similar things throughout these chapters. He says to covet to prophesy, to desire the best gift, be zealous concerning spiritual gifts. All of those words speak of hunger. They speak of going after something. And here's a little secret that will help you. The gifts of the Holy Spirit, the manifestations of the Holy Spirit, they work by desire. They don't work because of maturity. They won't come into manifestation because, you know, you've been saved 14 years. They won't even come into manifestation because you live a holy life. They work by desire. God meets us, you know, when we desire them, when we get on our knees and we seek God and we pray about them. It's just like revival. You know why we haven't had revival? It's because we're willing to live without it. But I feel that we're coming into a season, the body of Christ, the church globally, We're coming into a season where the gifts of the Holy Spirit will once again be accentuated. I believe that God is doing something, and He's doing it in response to the hunger and the prayers of His church. People are desiring the supernatural. They're wanting to see the things that we read about in the book of Acts. I mean, God hasn't changed. The Holy Spirit hasn't changed. But you know, we've just gotten so prim and so proper and you know, so put into this box and this box, and everything's so organized. And sometimes we've organized the Holy Spirit and what He wants to do right out of the church. So before we talk about this, where He said, pursue love, let's just talk for a moment or two about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1, He said, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I don't want you to be ignorant. You know, there's not many things in the Bible that God has said, I don't want you to be ignorant about this. And here Paul, speaking by the inspiration of the Spirit, this is Scripture. He said, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. Now, if you're brethren, if you're part of the body of Christ, God does not want you ignorant about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. What do you know about them? Have you studied them? Have you sought them? Have you read about them? Have you prayed about them? You know, it's interesting to me that, at least with some people I've met, and in some circles, you know, in the church, brothers and sisters that love the Lord, that I love, and we have fellowship, yet it seems to me that they've almost gone out of their way to be ignorant about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And some people are downright afraid of them. But He said, look, I don't want you to be ignorant. You need to know about these gifts. And He goes on here in verse 4, He says, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, or some translations say special faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit. And it is actually plural in the Greek language. It's not just gift of healing, it's the gifts of healings. There's a series of gifts within this gift, just like if you'd look at a bunch of grapes on one stalk, one gift of healing wouldn't heal all different types of disease. There may be as many different gifts within this gift as there are diseases. And then He said, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. Now, just for the purpose of understanding and just a little bit of study along these lines, there's three different categories of gifts mentioned here. He talks about nine manifestations or nine gifts of the Spirit. There are three that say something, three that reveal something, and there are three that do something. The three gifts that say something are the gifts of different kind of tongues, the interpretation of tongues, and the gifts of the gift of prophecy, which speaks to men by the inspiration of the Spirit to edification, exhortation, and comfort, we find in the 14th chapter. The three gifts that reveal something, the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, and the discerning of spirits. There's three gifts that do something, or they're sometimes referred to as the three power gifts, the working of miracles, the gifts of healings, and the gift of special faith. Now, down at the end of this chapter, 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 31, He said, but earnestly desire, there's that word again, desire the best gifts, and yet I show to you a more excellent way. Now, somebody says, what's the best gift? Well, I reckon it's the one that you need at the time. If you're sick, you probably don't need a prophecy. You need the gifts of healings. And by the way, in the Greek language, both gifts and healings is in the plural. There may be a series of gifts within this gift. There may be as many gifts within this gifts as there are diseases. Just think of it like a bunch of grapes on one stalk. So you probably need the gifts of healings. That's going to be the best gift if you're sick or someone that you love is sick. If someone's discouraged, downcast, well, they may need, you know, a prophecy by the inspiration of the Spirit, someone speaking to them to edification, exhortation, and comfort. So he said, desire the best gifts. And then said an interesting thing. He said, yet I show to you a more excellent way. And then he goes right into the 13th chapter. And we need to remember that there's not chapter divisions in the original, you know, letters here. I mean, we have chapter 12, chapter 13, chapter 14, but it was all just one continuous, you know, thought from the Apostle Paul as he wrote to the church in Corinth. He goes right in talking about what this more excellent way is. Chapter 13, verse 1, he says, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. He says, and though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I'm nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. The more excellent way is love. And here he talks about, actually mentions gifts from all three categories here. He talks about, tongues of men and angels, which would be different kinds of tongues. He talks about prophecy. He talks about knowledge, special faith. So he's talking about the gifts of the Spirit still. But he said the more excellent way is love. That's the Spirit that should characterize their use. And, you know, the gift can be genuine, but if I'm not walking in love, it doesn't say that it's not a genuine gift, but it says it just becomes noise. I remember a church that I attended, and there was this woman. She would prophesy in the services. And, you know, everything she said was scriptural, and it was actually good. If you'd written the words down on a paper and read them, you would have been edified. But every time she spoke, everyone in the church just cringed. It had the effect of dragging something very sharp and jagged across a chalkboard. It just had the opposite effect of edifying and comforting. Later, I found out this woman had some very deep-seated issues with bitterness and unforgiveness. It wasn't that the gift was genuine. I mean, it wasn't that the gift was not genuine. It was just picking up who she was, like a water flowing through a garden hose. It picks up the taste of the hose. The gifts are inspired by the Spirit, they're imparted by the Spirit, but he only has fallible human vessels. And it will pick up the taste of who we are. And she had some nasty, ugly things in her hose, and that gift as it flowed through picked up the taste of it. But you know, the scriptures tell us to speak the truth in love. You know, I look at it this way. You know, you've got the truth. That's like the wire that carries the power. Love is the insulation that should surround it. Here I am in the studio. You can't see them, but I can see some wires in different places. And they're bringing the blessing of electricity in here. Actually, the temperature in here is being regulated. There's lights that are on, cameras that are working. It's great. But that same wire that's bringing that power in, if it wasn't insulated, every one of these wires has insulation, it could hurt, it could harm, it could even kill, for that matter. And you know, when it comes to love, when it comes to the gifts of the Holy Spirit in operation, or us just encouraging someone with the truth of Scripture, we need to speak the truth in love. It's, you know, that the inspiration comes from God, but it's up to us to walk in love. I remember when I was a young Christian, I mean, I'm brand new saved and just come out of the world. And I remember there was this couple that attended like the same group of Christians that I did. We would gather and study the Bible. And, you know, they were saved. They'd given their lives to Jesus, but it was this guy and this girl. They'd been living together for about a year. And, you know, that's outside of the bounds of what God says is good. And, you know, he is smarter than we are. The moment you start thinking you know better than the Bible, you are in trouble. One of the greatest revelations I ever had is that God is smarter than me. And God in his word says that sex is good. He created it, but it's for the context of marriage. One woman, one man, marriage. And so this couple, they're living together, you know, as though married, but they're not. But they're brand new Christians. And so a couple of the older brothers in the Lord that I had gotten to know, I was talking with them about it one day, and they were sharing with me, said, you know, we need to talk to them because it's not according to what God says should be. And if he loves this girl, well, he needs to marry her, but they shouldn't be living together as husband and wife if they're not husband and wife. And, you know, they went and they talked to them, but they did it in such a spirit of love. They shared the truth, but it was insulated in love. They didn't come in with a big hammer and say, God is going to get you. What you're doing is wrong. It's evil. It's sinful. No, they came in a spirit of love. They opened up the Bible. They talked about, you know, the Christian witness we're supposed to have, and the world is watching, and that God is smarter than we are, and this is the principle, this is the way that God has set it out. And you know, that couple, that they were a little offended at first, but they could see that it was actually being done out of a spirit of love, and they received it. And they actually separated for a period of time, and then they got married and did it God's way. So my friend, yes, we need to desire spiritual gifts. We need to speak the truth, but we need to do it in a spirit of love. Maybe you've been in a church before, and by the time you got out, you felt like somebody had been hitting you over the head with a mallet. The preacher may have been preaching the truth, but if it's not done in a spirit of love, and that doesn't mean you can't be bold. That doesn't mean you cannot be direct. I believe in being direct. I believe in being bold, but I also believe in doing what we do with a spirit of love. Yes, God is a righteous God, but he's also a God of love. Yes, God is a God of holiness, but he is also a God of love and forgiveness. So may everything we do, may it be done in a spirit of love. You see, I can be inspired by the Holy Spirit and have a gift or a manifestation of the Spirit flowing through me. And it doesn't mean that the gift is not genuine. It just says, if I don't have love, I'm nothing. It didn't say the gift is nothing. It says it profits me nothing. It doesn't say that it may not profit someone else. You know, there may be some profit there, but if we are not walking in love, we dull the gifts of the Spirit. We mute the impact that they can have. And, you know, you may know someone that operates in all the gifts of the Spirit from time to time. Who knows? Maybe you've got certain gifts in your life, but if you're not walking in love, it will profit you nothing. And it is our choice to walk in love. God is the one that imparts the gifts. And, you know, fortunately, unfortunately, the only vessels he has to use, they are flawed. They are fallible. And so we need to be growing in grace and growing in love. And I know there's some people watching me. You've got some nasty things that are clogging up your hose. And, you know, when the fresh, pure water of the Holy Spirit flows through, you know, by the time it comes out, you know, to whoever you're ministering to, it's tainted because it picks up the taste of the hose. So if you need to forgive, forgive. If you need to get rid of that root of bitterness, go before God, get on your face, and don't get up until God does his roto-rooter on you and gets your heart clean again. It is so important, especially in connection with the gifts of the Spirit, that we walk in love. And you might say, well, you know, I've got my own definition of love. Well, that may be true, but that doesn't mean your definition of love is true. I think there people have a lot of different things that they consider, all right, this is what love looks like, but that doesn't mean that you know, it's accurate. And as we go on here in this same chapter, 1 Corinthians 13, God actually gives us a definition of what his kind of love and the kind of love he's talking about looks like. Let me read to you. It says this in 1 Corinthians 13, I'm going to begin in verse 4 from the Amplified Bible. It says, love endures long and is patient and kind. You know, there's some people that they endure long, but they're not patient and kind while they do it. Love endures long and is patient and kind. Love is never envious, never boils over with jealousy. is not boastful or vainglorious, does not display itself haughtily. It is not conceited, arrogant, and inflated with pride. It is not rude, unmannerly, and does not act unbecomingly. Love, God's love in us, does not insist on its own rights or its own way. Does that sound like you? How are you in the marriage? You always insisting on your own rights and your own way? Does it always have to be your way? Well, that is not love. He goes on and he says, for it is not, love of God in us is not self-seeking. It is not touchy or fretful or resentful. It takes no account of the evil done to it. It pays no attention to a suffered wrong. Now, I know there's some people that if they get offended, man, they just hang on to that offense. I heard a phrase the other day for the very first time, Irish Alzheimer's. Now, I'm Irish, and the definition that the person gave says, well, yeah, the Irish, they forget everything except their grudges. Well, you know what? There are some people that just don't let go of a wrong that they've been suffered, but the love of God in us does. It goes on, says, it does not rejoice at injustice and unrighteousness, but rejoices when right and truth prevail. Love bears up under anything and everything that comes, is ever ready to believe the best of every person. Its hopes are fadeless under all circumstances, and it endures everything without weakening. Love never fails, never fades out, or becomes obsolete, or comes to an end. And the fact is, that kind of love we just read about, that's what God's love is. And if you're a believer, it's already been deposited in your heart. Romans 5:5 says, the love of God has been shed abroad. It has been poured out into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. It is released by a choice. If you're saved, that love is in you. And when we read the phrase, pursue love, it's not a matter of pursuing something that's vacant from us. It's a matter of realizing that it's there and making the conscious choice to let it be expressed through us. And that's what he means when he says, pursue love. Pursue the expression of that love that's already been poured out in your heart by the Holy Spirit. And if you begin to walk in love, my friend, when these manifestations of the Spirit that God, he wants to show forth and to help people in supernatural ways more than we want it. And as we begin to desire and pray about those things, if we're walking in love, oh, the impact that we can have. Love is the more excellent way. And there is, I think, however, a key to developing that will help us walk in God's love. And it's really pretty simple. Romans 12, verses 1 and 2, he says, I beseech you, brethren, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. All right? How do I do that? Verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. He said, don't be conformed to this world. And that word conformed literally means to be squeezed into a mold from outside pressures. He said, rather, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And the word transformed is the Greek word metamorpho. It's where we get our English word metamorphosis. It means to allow what's on the inside to come to the outside. A friend of mine was fishing one day in a little pond. He was out there the whole day. Out there about 10 hours just fishing. It was a quiet day. He was the only one there. And a little nymph crawled up on his boat. Now, in case you don't know, it looks like this little water beetle. Actually looks like this alien form of life. And it's what happens. A dragonfly will lay its egg, and then it hatches and is underwater the whole first part of its life and is this little nymph. And then when the time comes, it crawls out and it'll attach itself to a branch of a bush or something. But this one had actually crawled the boat and stopped in the middle of the seat. It was a rowboat in the middle of the seat in front of him. And he just sat there while he's fishing, casting his line out, watching this thing. Sun was hot. It dried out. He said, after a few hours, the back just cracked open. Something began to wriggle out. It blew his mind. He says, it was a little dragonfly. It got there, dried its wings in the sun for several more hours, just sat there. He fished for hours and he's watching this thing, and all of a sudden went, and it flew away. Well, what happened to that dragonfly? It says it went through a metamorphosis. What was on the inside came to the outside. And you know, God's love has been deposited in our heart. The Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 7, he said, I delight in the law of God after the inward man. In other words, in my spirit, in my heart, I want to do what's right. I want to walk in God's way. I want to walk in love. I want to obey his word. He said, but I see another, you know, thing at work in my body that wants to bring me into subjection, because our bodies still have the sin nature in them. One day we're going to get a new body likened to his glorified body. You know, this corruption is going to put on incorruption, but in the meantime, we have this treasure in earthen vessels. So the love of God is in here. This desire to do right is in my heart. All right, how do I, you know, pursue love to the point that I begin to express love in my actions, in my words, and when the gifts of the Spirit are in operation, that it can flow through this, you know, this clean vessel? How can I do that? Well, he tells us. We let what's on the inside come to the outside. We're transformed by the renewing of our mind. If we will have a steady diet of God's word in our life, it can change everything. In fact, let me just put it this way to make it simple. You're a spirit, you have a soul, that's your mind, your will, your emotions, and you live in a physical body. All right, if you're saved, your spirit has the nature of God in it. The love of God has been poured in there. Your body still has the nature of sin in it, and caught in between is your mind. Whatever you fill your mind with, just consider it something that's on a hinge. Whatever you fill your mind with, the hinge is going to swing that way. If you fill your mind with garbage and you know, the latest thing that the media is saying and you know, this and that and stuff you shouldn't be listening to and watching, well, your mind is going to swing the way of the flesh. But if you will renew your mind with the truth of God's word, your mind will swing the direction of your spirit. And if I will renew my mind with the word of God, what happens is my spirit, my mind will gang up on my body. And even though my body wants to retaliate, even though in my flesh, I want to hold on to that grudge, I want to be angry, I want to insist on my own way. No, my renewed mind says, that's not God's way. This is what God says. And my mind and my spirit come into alignment. And I will bring my body under subjection, is what the Apostle Paul said. And then I can walk in love. And then I can walk in God's way. My friend, you need to have a love affair with your Bible. And if you're a believer, the love of God has been poured out into your heart. Pursue love. Renew your mind with the word of God. And as we come into what I believe is a season where the manifestations of the Spirit are going to be abundant, awe-inspiring, and God is going to reach down into our midst and do supernatural things, he's looking for people that have chosen to walk in love. So, hey, I'm going to pursue love. Won't you pursue love with me? Let us walk in love. Let us pursue love. And let us desire spiritual gifts. And when we do, God will not be long in meeting us. Well, I hope that you found that message helpful. And the truth is, I didn't nearly get to everything that I wanted to get to. It's just such a broad subject. And I trust that you're going to join us for this series as we continue talking about great pursuits. Father, I just bless and I pray for my friend that's watching right now. I ask you to open the understanding of their heart. Give them eyes to see, ears to hear, a heart to comprehend. I ask you to bless them and help them in Jesus' name. And I want to say thank you. You know, there are people that support us financially and with prayers, and they do it consistently. They do it as unto the Lord. And I pray that they would be blessed, but I just want you to know how grateful we are. I'm grateful. Our whole team is grateful. It allows us to carry messages like this around the world. So may God bless you richly.
Everyone is chasing something. The perfect job, the perfect relationship, financial security. Many of the things we pursue are good things, but do they have eternal value? Are they really the things that matter? In Bayless Conley's brand new book, Great Pursuits, Chasing What Matters Most in Life, Bayless reveals the things that God says are worth pursuing. From purpose to perspective, happiness to hospitality, Bayless gives you the practical guide to finding the things in life worth chasing, and then the easy ways to pursue them every day. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and get great pursuits for a gift of $19 or more, you'll uncover how simple obedience to God's plan can unlock the passion, purpose, and healing available to you. God created you for so much more than you could ever imagine. The life He offers, the promises He's made, and the purpose you have are significant. That's why we should use every moment chasing after God's best. Available in physical, digital, and audiobook versions for a gift of just $19. Great Pursuits will show you how to connect with your purpose by following God's Word. You'll learn how to grow in character both personally and within your relationships. What you pursue matters. In order to lead a life of victory, make sure you're pursuing the right things with Great Pursuits. Don't miss this special offer. Go online right now to BaylessConley.com to get Great Pursuits. That's BaylessConley.com.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.